Well, I started out in the early 90s. I was the first gang specialist hired by the state of Texas. My job was to essentially go into youth prisons and some of those young early adult prisons and deal with the gang phenomenon that happened in the 90s. Job was to negotiate peace in those environments and then furlough those young men out and allow them to go back to their neighborhoods and talk with their OGs and their leaders to ask them to give them free passage back into their world. You know, in this culture, it's less gang, it's more identity with whatever area, whatever neighborhood, whatever scenario that you're in, you identify with that, so that becomes your protection, it becomes your identity, it becomes your way of life. So someone has to figure out how to go through that system and say, let's get reality from those false identities, those falsehoods. And so, but you gotta be careful, because no matter if it's false or not, if someone believes it, they'll die for it, they'll kill for it, they'll live for it. So you have to know how to use whatever influences you have to bring about a different perspective. Man, I'm gonna tell you, once I did a gang negotiation with the Aryan Brotherhood, right, the Aryan Nation, the Nazis. And when they gathered, they all had to affirm their belief system. And it was so interesting. The guy, he looked around his group and he said, we hate blacks and we hate Hispanics and we hate, and then he looked at me, he said, but not you, sir. We don't feel like that about you. I said, thank you, man. Because what I realized, what he said to me was, man, we need you right now. So let's just, you know, this our speech. That's not necessarily entrenched. And that guy became one of the leaders of this Umoja Council that we did in the prison, which is a unity council. But the point I'm making is that enemies come when there is true violation, not true rhetoric. See, rhetoric don't make enemies, man. It's just, you know, you gotta go past that. You know, there's some stuff that I promise you I would not say on camera that me and my wife has argued about, and you would think, boy, they are enemies. No, they just, she didn't want that kind of TV, and I want, you know, and it just got out of hand. So sometimes you have to go beyond the rhetoric so you can see the real. And then, so you gotta classify a person with an enemy with their intent, with their consistent behavior, and it's a whole, you know, it's a whole broad range when you're trying to deal like that. And so you gotta be very, very, very careful when you're doing it, because you never know who you're gonna need on many, many, many sides. So that's how I see enemies. So you're right about that. It's very rare that in my spirit I say that's an enemy, because that you can't do that. In the work that I do, you would really limit your influence and limit your access if you thought in those terms. You know, I did work with Paul Ryan. He was doing a poverty tour with a mentor, my mentor Bob Woodson, and it was called What Works and Why. And he was going around to see what really works. And he had this idea called A Better Way Forward. And so they came to Dallas. I had no knowledge of him. He came to Dallas to come see my work. And one of his first trips when he became Speaker of the House was, I do a big celebration every MLK Day where I bring healers from all over the city of Dallas then, but now all over the nation. They came together to just affirm what we were doing and to revisit where we were. One of his first trips, he came there and was there strictly to listen. He stayed for a few hours just listening to everyone and talking and in that space. And it was so interesting how the perception was not the reality. Because most people who work in neighborhoods, you know, they have a philosophy that would say it don't lean toward where you are, Paul. But he was as comfortable in that moment as I was when he brought us up to talk to a group of guys who were conservatives. And we did a deal at American Enterprise Institute and other places where we were just trying to share our ideas. And what we started realizing is there's not a lot of separation. The separation is very small. And so we began to just work in that sense. Yeah, you know, perspective comes from where you are. I never forget when Paul and I first met, I was saying, what is he trying to gain from this? And his direct answer was information. I don't know what I don't know, so teach me. Show me what it means to be in this moment, and then I'm going to show you where I am. And then he said something that was very powerful. He said, Omar, there are people who are poised to help you that you wouldn't meet. But I want to introduce you to this world. And I'm skeptical because I'm working in the streets saying, right, anybody who want to help me, I pretty much know. And I was wrong. So we met at a vulnerable place where we both could learn. And the power of that relationship is that we didn't have to start hiding from real issues to work together. Charles Koch said something that was so strong to me. He said, what do we fiercely agree upon? And let's work like hell to make it happen. I said, I like that. What do we fiercely agree upon? So do we really agree that everyone should be a citizen? Yeah. Do we really agree that poverty should not be the destination? It could be a transportation, but not yet. Do we really agree that anyone can transformation? Yeah, redemption. Yeah. So we just start figuring out what we agree upon, and it was easy to have real relationship. So Paul then, for me, it was not political, it was real. And then when we had real disagreements, they were coming from a pure place. Paul, I don't agree with this policy. He said, yeah, but I don't agree with it. It's cool. And we didn't have any heartburn. We had true ideas that could play out in the theater, ideas, and see what happens. But the goal was bigger than the role. See, it was not us trying to figure this thing out. So it stopped being this conversational piece of we figuring out how we play the game with each other. It started really being, do we add value to each other, and are we solving things that other people run away from? And this in this environment of us versus them, right versus left, red versus blue, up, all of those things create the most echo chambered life that you can have, and it's going to have major consequences when you really have to solve deep problems. You cannot solve problems that way. That's insane. You can't do that.